In 1437, Thomas Langley, Bishop of Durham, died. As Chancellor to three kings, he had led a great life that influenced matters of state and religion. He transformed Durham Cathedral, building a new shrine to his beloved St. Cuthbert at the east end of the church. Also, with Middleton Parish Church, he established a new collegiate church in Manchester, which is now the cathedral. In death, he made one final statement. He had his own tomb built in Durham Cathedral at the opposite end to St. Cuthbert's. It stands to this day in front of the massive west doors blocking the entrance. Everyone who enters Durham Cathedral must go around Middleton's Thomas Langley.
The humble Middletonian could reach such heights meant that the Middle Ages, with its feudal structures and restrictions, was coming to an end. A new era dawned.
With St. Cuthbert and Cardinal Langley, Middleton is irretrievably linked to Durham and the North. But with the coming of the Renaissance, Middleton became embroiled with another great city. In Middleton, Alexander Noel is remembered by the road in his name, the old grammar school, and the image in the Langley window of the parish church. Like Thomas Langley before him, Noel was a true Renaissance man, hailing as he did from a modest background to become a figure of high prominence. He was educated at Langley's original school within Middleton, and then went to Brasenose College, Oxford. He was elected a Fellow of Brasenose in 1526. In the court of Elizabeth I, Noel was a controversial figure. Not only had he developed Puritan views, but he was known to cross the monarch at times. He was fundamentally in sympathy. But once even the Queen interrupted his sermons and told him to stick to the text and stop slighting the image of Christ on the cross. There's also a story that he invented bottled beer. This was around 440 years ago. The tale goes that when Alexander Noel was a priest in Hertfordshire, he would go fishing and take a bottle filled with his home brew. However, he forgot about it and left it on the bank of the river.
So when he returned, some days later, the still full bottle had effervesced and undergone a second fermentation. So, to quote, when he opened the bottle, he found no bottle, but a gun, such was the sound of the opening thereof.
This is commonly taken to be the origins of bottled beer in England. In 1572, he successfully petitioned the Queen and built what we know now as the Old Grammar School, but correctly, the Queen Elizabeth Grammar School. When built, it would have been one of the largest buildings in Middleton, an advanced and expensive building of its time, being constructed of stone rather than timber. Architecturally, one of the main influences was from the Italian Renaissance, a symmetrical style that was beginning to inform many prominent buildings across Europe, including Noel's cherished Brasenose College. In fact, the carving of the roof truss over the entrance is of a Brasenose, or Brazen Nose. This motif was subsequently repeated elsewhere in the building. This was combined with practical stylings of the period, such as mullioned windows beneath a long drip mould. It was designed to maximise the available light. Successful outcome of the Battle of Flodden Field, Richard Ashton set about enlarging Langley's church. He extended the north aisle and created the new Langley Chapel.
He built the priest vestry in the south and east walls of the Ashton Chapel. Story, he brought the south arcade 6 feet this way.
This accounts for the Norman arch not being central to the west wall. This then allowed the construction of the flat nave roof. Ashton added the decorative castellations to the aisle walls and the south porch. The Pope in Rome had granted young Henry a dispensation to marry his brother's widow, Catherine of Aragon. However, she was unable to bear him the son he so desperately needed for the continuance of his line. In short, he wanted a new wife.
So now, Henry was in a tricky situation. He wanted the Pope to dispense with his earlier dispensation so he could remarry. The Pope refused. So Henry, in short order, cut off his ties with Rome and the Pope and set up a national religion, the Church of England, with himself at its head.
So church-going remained unchanged in all but one respect. Masses were spoken in English and not Latin. So Henry had banned Greek and Latin. So while this was a blow for the scholars and the clergy, it meant for the first time the common man could understand and read the scriptures. The more far-reaching consequences were that more and more Renaissance figures came from humble origins. Dictionaries, Bibles, works of art, an entire culture became accessible to the man in the street. If it were not for the Reformation, we might never have heard of the works of Christopher Marlowe, Holinshed's Chronicles, or Shakespeare. While Middleton's oldest pub, the Old Boar's Head, dates from 1632, it was originally a coaching inn, a stopping point on the road between Chester and York. This part of the road is what we now know as Long Street. There have been many alterations to the building over the years, including the large 18th century annex, which was once used as a local courtroom, hence the name the Sessions Room. Local legends abound. Many believe that there's a tunnel going from the pub to St. Leonard's Church. It was supposed to be a bolt hole for cavaliers in order to escape Oliver Cromwell's roundheads during the English Civil War. However, no such tunnel exists. There is a tunnel from the church, and this goes to near the edge of St. Leonard's Square. In fact, it ran to a pub on the square opposite the Ring of Bells called The Grapes, but this pub is no longer there. It is said that a mysterious cowled figure can be sometimes seen at night, the ghost of a murdered cavalier haunting the churchyard. The English Civil War began in 1642. It was a conflict between the Crown and Parliament. The Royalists, or Cavaliers, supported King Charles I. While the Parliamentarians, or Roundheads, were led by Oliver Cromwell.
Often referred to in the singular, there are actually three civil wars. The Royalists were defeated in each one. The first was 1642 to 46.
The second, 1648 to 49, at the end of which Charles I was executed. And the third, 1649 to 51, saw the supporters of Charles II rise up. The first signatory on Charles I's death warrant has a connection with Middleton. Richard Bradshaw of Bradshaw Hall, Alcrington, near Middleton Junction. During the 1640s, the Civil Wars saw major pitched battles throughout England and Wales. But supposedly, the first recorded death was a fight in a Manchester banqueting hall in 1642 during initial talks. Artillery Street and Cannon Street in Manchester are so called because of the Civil War. Thank you. Middleton's Ralph Asherton was a prominent figure. He was offered a knighthood, which he refused, in order to pursue a career in politics.
In 1640, he was elected MP for Lancashire. When civil war broke out, he became Major General on the side of the parliamentarians.
During initial preparations for war, arms and gunpowder were secretly stored in castles and churches. These were much coveted by both sides.
So, in 1642, when the royalist Lord Strange came to Manchester to claim his barrels of explosives, the cupboard was bare.
Cannily, Ralph Asherton had had them removed unlawfully, which further confounded and enraged the opposition. Ralph was made Commander-in-Chief of the Parliamentary Forces in Lancashire, and Middleton's cavalry played an important part throughout the war. Despite his role in the Parliamentarian army, Ralph was actually opposed to the execution of Charles I. There is a unique brass memorial of Major General Asherton in St. Leonard's Church. It is the only known brass depiction of a Civil War officer in full armour. The Battle of Flodden Field in 1513 was the last great battle of medieval times, and the last battle fought on English soil against Scotland. The Middleton archers played a significant role. Basically, James IV of Scotland had strong allegiances with France. Henry VIII of England was fighting France at the time. So as a ploy to divide the English forces intended for the continent, the Scots set out to take over northern England. It didn't help that Henry had boasted many times that he considered himself the overlord of Scotland. Needless to say, the rift between the two countries was, and still is, an age-old rancour. However, Henry, a supreme strategist, had anticipated the Scottish invasion. Thomas Howard, Earl of Surrey, was dispatched to form an army from detachments based in the Midlands and the north of England. Archers were recruited, mostly from the counties of Lancashire and Cheshire. Although the Scottish forces were superior in numbers, the result of the hard-won battle was decisive for England. The Scots suffered almost twice as many casualties. This was, in no small part, due to the use of the long-handled billhook and the extraordinary abilities of the Lancashire and Cheshire bowmen. And the Middleton archers were at the forefront, led by Richard Asherton. The English longbow was a mighty advantage. Why fight hand-to-hand when you can hurl missiles over great distances? Flodden saw the last decisive use of the weapon.
Most of them were in churchyards because of the poisonous berries of the yew tree. And one of the reasons for using the yew is if you take the heart of the tree, that in itself is more restrictive to either... It's the other way around, to the outside of the tree, the sapling side, if you like, and the heart of the tree, because one of them will resist contraction and the other will resist stretching. So this is why that particular tree was used. And this is why you don't find many yew trees in the churchyards of today.
It was the largest ever battle between the two kingdoms. James IV was killed. No monarch has died on a British battlefield since. After the battle, Middleton's hero, Richard Assheton, was knighted.
It is interesting that the battle didn't take place at Flodden at all. The conflict actually occurred at Brankston, some 3.5 miles away.
In 8 years before the Battle of Flodden, Richard Assheton commissioned a window commemorating the Middleton archers. It later became a memorial, and it's believed to be the oldest stained glass war memorial in the world.
The glass was still...
...to move from 26 houses to before they overcome.
Our next film will deal with Middleton and the Age of Enlightenment. It'll include the Industrial Revolution, the reformist Samuel Bamford, and the Peterloo Massacre.